afternoon. So I will be presenting a bit the big data activities at BSC. So first a bit of motivation, why big data activities at BSC? Because apparently there are different worlds, no? But and then however, we've seen a need of convergence from both works, no? And there are activities like the VDEC meetings that are periodically organized, no? If you look at the two ecosystems, this chart is by Dan Reed, has been presented in different meetings and in a paper. So you have for HPC, you have in the architecture, you have usually local storage, and then you have accelerator CPUs in the compute nodes, InfiniBand, what have been described this morning, no? But in data analytics data centers, usually you have more commodity GPUs there are, since now has been less common, local storage, Ethernet switches. And in terms of the software, most of cases both are based on Linux. Then cloud services, VMs, containers, all these are common in big data, while usually in HPC it seems like a bit scary. HDFS is the Hadoop file system, is the traditional in the big data areas, while in the others we have Lustre, we have then batch schedulers, things like this. Programming models, traditional programming models, and big data here in the slide, Spark is missing, which probably is the big player right now. We have MapReduce. In HPC, we have more like MPI, OpenMP, different numerical algebra libraries, etc. And in terms of programming languages, also the difference is quite important. No, while we are used to Fortran and C and IDs, here people speak about Java, Python, and then you have other more specific things like Mahout, R, and so on. No, so and in essence, besides one by one are different, if you look, it's not that different, no? We have like the same layers and the same ideas, no? The same topics, no? And still, what we think is that for high-end data analytics are very important for HPC, no? Because HPC simulators generate large amounts of data, and these big simulations then that generate these big data amounts require to be analyzed, no? And in order to get a quick analysis, we need these techniques from the big data analytics, no? And the centers with hybrid expertise, if you look around, it's not very common, but you see the trend, no? That people every time is applying these techniques into these HPC simulations. And overall, there is worldwide activity on the conversions on data analytics and in HPC applications, no? At BSC, we do activities at very different levels, no? From if you look in the research, this chart was generated a couple of years ago when we tried to match the big data activities that we were doing at BSC. And here we have the different layers of a computer architecture, from the hardware, operating system, so on, till applications. And we discovered that we were doing things at the very different levels, no? From accelerating with hardware the databases, from managing the distributed applications, from programming models, from deploying a Spark in Mare Nostrum, for example, and till applications. So we have a large spectrum of things that we are doing. Some cases in the framework of projects funded by the European Union, and in other cases directly with industry. Additionally, we are doing training activities. These are very few. We have this big storage ETN. ETN is a type of instrument of the European Union to organize different centers doing training activities, PhD training activities. They are very well recognized. ESADE is very well known management school in Barcelona, and we have been doing a master module on big data technologies. But imagine teaching technologies in people that knows about management. No? So it's been a challenge. Eh? We have a module there. And then we have some courses in the PADSI program that I mentioned this morning, that is one of the PRACE training centers that we have in Barcelona. We have a 4 days data analytics course day, which is usually very, the registration is quite high. Another thing about big data is that has been a reason for doing cross-department collaborations, no? Because usually have like the applications departments that generate, have the big simulations and do the generation of big data. And then in the computer science are more the department, the groups that have been doing some research on this area. No? So this has been a reason, especially through the Severo Ochoa program that I was also mentioning this morning, where we get the funds to do these activities. And overall, we are in different activities and initiatives in road mapping and convergence, like BDBA was a project on road mapping for big data, very close to the industry, or the ETP for HPC, which is an institution doing road mappings more for HPC. The RDA also, where we have data activities, no? Or the BDEC, which is a specific forum for the convergence between big data and exascale. And so the line of the talk, which we tried to be faster so we can go earlier to the coffee break, I will try to cover a bit the different topics that I think are interesting for this fora, from the different tools and software that we are developing at BSC, then applications also done at BSC, and then very quickly cover the European projects where we are working and projects with industry where we are involved. No? In terms of tools, one of the expertises of BSC is in programming models. No? In this sense, we've been working in COMS. COMS is an instance of our task-based programming model that tackles a large distributed computing applications, no? Distributed computing like clouds or in clusters as well. No? Recently, we have added support for Python because it's one of the languages that are common in the big data area. No? The idea is that then we can use PyComs, or especially in the Python binding, as an alternative to Spark. With this sense, we are doing, for example, comparison of performance of applications done in our programming model and with Spark. Another thing that is in our area, in our roadmap, is to try to do interoperability with Spark. Since our programming model is a bit more generic than Spark, for example, offer a layer of interoperability implementing the different operators of Spark on top of COMS. No? This is something that we are considering. Additionally, what we have been doing in terms of storage, for example, is an object oriented library of what we call self-contained object. What is a self-contained object? You have two main characteristics. First, that you have the data and the methods together. So it's not the same as the objects that were described this morning. It's not only data, but also the methods. And these objects are then distributed, and you can consider them in a distributed computing platform. And the other thing is that these objects are persistent. So by now, we are using persistency through databases like Cassandra or Postgres. But in the future, we aim to have these objects persistent through NVRAMs or SSDs. Okay? So we are working with this type of initiatives as well. Well, they have other characteristics, but I think it's not necessary to go through all. Another initiative, ECUBA. ECUBA is a set of management and planning strategies to map Python data structures into Cassandra. So you can have a Python database, and by means of these tools, are mapped into Cassandra, in a Cassandra cluster. How helps this? Well, it helps that the data, similarly to the previous case, where the objects remain persistent, in the same case, what you have is the objects that are in the programming application are at execution time are in memory. In fact, they are already persistent. So it's a very easy way of implementing producer-consumer applications. And this, for example, for doing applications where you have simulation, and at the same time you want to do visualization or analysis, it's a way of working, no? Having this way of coupling the applications. Then related to the first thing I said, the programming model and these other initiatives on storage, the two that I mentioned or others that we can consider, what we've been doing also at BSC is having a way to interoperate between all of them. No? So we defined a common storage API so we can, from the runtime, the same applications in the same programming model, can choose one or another backend for store the data. Hmm? And more, what is more, with this layer that I was mentioning, with a programming model, a storage API, and so we aim to provide a layer that provides programming environments for big data applications, for example, to provide a set of, we can call it analytics as a service, no? The PyComs applications can be deployed as services. This is one of another characteristic of the environment. So you can think of Skykit Learn, for example, is a common library for doing data learning and analytics. So if we parallelize them on top of PyComs and using this storage technology, is a way of offering libraries of analytics for the users of our center. And another thing that is available at BSC for big data users is the Spark for Mare Nostrum. It's a specific deployment of a Spark in Mare Nostrum. So every time a user wants to use Spark Mare Nostrum, can use this set of commands that will deploy the Spark application and the HPFS file system on top of GPFS. So it's making this analogy of you have that you have a big data data center in Mare Nostrum, no? And it's managed by these different commands. So by issuing an application with Spark 4mm, which has a set of scripts that you need to configure, you can deploy your application on Mare Nostrum and running a Spark application. You can do benchmarking, so then this will deploy n jobs, not only one. And also you can generate plots, so we have different tools for this. And this is the one that we are using, for example, to compare with the comms I was saying before. We are comparing with Spark, we are using this Spark 4mm. Okay. And then with regard to infrastructure, we have at BSC, we have Mare Nostrum, as I was mentioning this morning, and that has a GPFS storage of 3 petabytes. And this will be the usual file system that the users will see. No? But additionally, we have an archive of 5.7 petabytes and growing because we have a lot large demand from our users. For example, from Earth Science, I know that they want much more than this for the next generation. And this archive, which is thought to store the results of the experiments of the applications that are running Mare Nostrum, can be accessed to different set of nodes, the DT nodes, that can access this data externally without going through Mare Nostrum, but also can be used to transfer in a more efficient way data from the regular GPFS storage into the archive. So this is everything very well organized. And the other thing is that if you want to perform the analytics will not make sense to be run on the Mare Nostrum supercomputer. You can run them services or an analytics can be run on these other nodes that run without the batch system and will access directly the archive. This was about like tools and in-house products that we have. Now more the applications that have been developed. One is Tiramisu. This is a very suggerent name, but it's about doing operations with images. No? So the actual things that you can do with this tool is to, for example, imagine you have the set of images of pandas, and you can operate, you can say, subtract the set of image of pandas from the set of images of birds, and what we'll say is that you will find out skunks or balls of football, no? So the idea will be to do reasoning based on images. How we do this? We work on top of existing toolkits like CAFE that generates from a set of images, will generate a representation of the classes of images, which are called activation set. No? And this is what then we can use to operate between them. Okay, then we can do this type of operations between the sets. You can do arithmetics, but also you can compute distances. They did an experiment, a very interesting experiment, of finding the distances between the classes of images that are living animals, living things, between all the others. And the result was that really there was a difference between them. No? So things that when we look at them, we find it very normal. Also operating with these vectors of the activation sets can be observed when calculating the distance. The idea is to provide them this toolkit as an easy of use for the data synthesis to do different type of further data analysis on the results of deep learning. And this has been parallelized on top of the programming model on top of PyComs. It's written in Python and parallelized by PyComs. Another example of application that is implemented on top of COMS is a genomic application. This is GIDANS. It's a tool for performing genome-wide association studies. So this compares genomes of different individuals, looking for the reasons for strange non-common diseases. Okay? So, for example, they have been using for analysis of the diabetes 2 and see using 70K patients, also was really a large experimentation. Or, for example, they have been doing analysis on 500,000 patients, comparing different, like up to 44 different genetic diseases, using the whole 1,000 whole genome sequences. So these are experiments that our life science department has been able to perform with this application, and thanks, as I say, thanks to collaborations between the departments. No? This has been deployed in the Broad Institute in Boston, for example, and we are working with other hospitals around the world. Another project on genomics, which has been in the press, is MOFIN. MOFIN is part a toolkit for the Pan Cancer Project, which is a worldwide project working on the in research on cancer. So it's trying to provide an alternative for the pipelines that they have. And it has been optimized for the execution in accelerators. No? In this case, it's MOFIN 2, it has been accelerated with GPUs and with FPGAs in collaboration with the computer science department. So this is another type of application that has been developed in this area. Another area that is a work in progress is with the Earth Science Department. With the Earth Science Department, what they work a lot is in a prediction of climate. For example, they are going to do an experiment in the Project Primavera that will produce 1.4 petabyte of data. No? And this, for example, is the type of data that they will store in the archive that I was mentioning before. No? So usually they use these climate models and they simulate it on the HPC system. This generates the data that is stored in the archive, and then they use the serial nodes to do the analytics and perform the diagnosis. No? So this is the traditional pipeline right now. No? What they want to do in the near project is to be able to do the diagnostics online. So while the simulation is being done in the HPC system, being able to do the online diagnostics at the same time. This will enable them to do better or more wider type of diagnostics. For example, they told me about the case of the tropical thunderstorms that are very difficult to predict because they can happen at any time and very fast. No? So if they do all this pipeline in this way, it's very difficult to predict these storms. But if they can do the diagnostics online, they will be able to predict this type of storms, for example. No? So this is a plan of use, for example, of these diagnostics analytics as a service that I was mentioning, no? And this will be one of the projects to do in the future. This is another example from the case department. This is the work, the department that works on applications more close to industry. Okay? In this case was a project with the Town Hall of Barcelona working on an energy plan in Barcelona. No? So these people, they have a lot of inputs from sensors, they have the information about the engines, the machine and so on, and what they wanted to do is automatic machine operation, so trying to plan the different activities of the plan, and for example being able to better plan, to better schedule the maintenance periods, for example. No? So they are using different analytics tools, machine learning, and different type of analytics together with computer simulations to do this application. Hmm? Another that has been also in the press is Algoritmo. This is an experiment that they did in the Sonar Festival. The Sonar Festival is an electronic music festival that is very well known in Barcelona, which attracts people from worldwide. No? And usually BSC, these people from CASE has a booth there and do something that attracts the interest of the press. No? In this case, what they did is trying to do generation of music based on information on a trained neural network, and trying to generate music, but also at the same time during the music festival, they asked the people to give feedback about the music that was generated at that time. No? And with this feedback, they were generating new songs and so on, no? Trying to compose automatically new songs. No? And so this is based on a recurrent neural network market. This is then deployed on Minotauro, which is our cluster that have GPUs, and was done during the festival, no? Online, no? With the people. And another application that can be considered a big data application at BSC is the set of performance analysis tools. No? I talked a bit this morning about this, and I thought about the browser Paraver that is able to visualize trace files of the applications that have been executed. No? It has a lot of detail of the execution, but of course if you have to go with the browser through all the details is very time consuming. No? So the idea is how we can extract automatically information from these long traces. No? And not only but one, because usually what we have is for one application we can have several traces, maybe with a different number of processors, and sometimes with traces that are from simulation. We have an MPI simulator that can generate then different cases with different architectures, different performance of the network, many different options, no? How to generate information, no? Knowledge from this. No? For example, they have implemented different cluster algorithms to get information about this. They also do techniques like sampling in order to generate less data or automatic. This also is another option, no? That it involves more tracing. This means that they will trace the only sample the trace at the specific moments, no? When there is interesting information to trace. And other things they do, for example, on this plot, what it shows is the trend of different traces depending on the parameters. No? This can be the number of CPUs, for example, then you can see the trend. And here is just a picture, but in half they can generate videos, animated GIFs, of how the performance evolves depending on the parameters of simulation. So this is another example of things we do. No? From terabytes of raw data, they can generate a few gigabytes of curated data that are then stored in the archive. Another example that is interesting is an experiment with coupling ALIA, which is a simulator that we have developed by the CASE department, and with visualization in ParaView. No? This is done an experiment of the simulating the respiratory system. There is a very nice video that our people generated with about the respiratory system that's called SNIF. If you look in the in our website, it's very nice to see, if you like. So what they have done in this case, another case of collaboration between the case department in this case and the computer science department. So they have been able to change the way the ALIA stores the data and storing part of the information of this respiratory system in the Cassandra database. But for this, they use a specific data structure, QBEST, that is based on a tree distribution gene. No? The idea is that if you want to zoom here the lungs and go deeper to see more information, this can be very slow with ParaView. Okay? So the idea was to speed up this visualization through this data structure that stores in a more efficient way the data in order to get these zooms more efficient. This right now is only a prototype, but the idea is to integrate it with a programming model and with other tools of the department to enable this type of coupling for other type of applications. Now in general, for results of simulations coupled with visualization, with analytics, whatever. So this was about the applications. Then I will just review a bit the projects that we are involved. As I said this morning, we have a lot of involvement in different funded projects. Here I'm highlighting a few of them which are more related to big data. Okay? One of them is of a very different nature that we have not never been involved in this type of project before. It's about automatic data extraction of information from textual sources. This is related to the law enforcement agencies, and for example, they will work on use cases based on insurance, for example. No? When somebody does a reports a robbery, for example, and trying to extract automatically information from textual sources in order to check if this information can be true or not, you know, as a support for these agencies to get the information. The BSC activities, in this sense, will be work on the support for defining the ontology and the automatic extraction of the information from the tasks, and also providing the infrastructure deployed in Mare Nostrum through the Spark4MN software. Okay? This is a project where the people from CASE is collaborating. Another one where my group is collaborating, this is a European-Brazilian project. It's a very type with the projects that the European Union funds. It's a bit difficult because you have the complexity of the collaboration overseas. And in this case, the topic is on big data. No? It's trying to provide a framework for doing big data applications, focusing on a specific use case. It's a navigation scenario for the buses of the city of Curitiba. It's a city, one of these big cities in Brazil, which they have a lot of problems with the transportation. So they want to enhance the situation. And in our case, the BSC is providing the programming model. It's providing comms, and we will do try to provide interoperability between Spark and comms, and also define an abstract layer for programming the different applications, the use cases of the project. Another one is NextGen.io. This is one of the EdgeFed HPC projects led by EPCC in Edinburgh. The idea would be how to integrate persistent storage. In this case, Intel is the provider of the technology, Intel 3D XPoint memories, how to integrate them into HPC systems. In our case, what we are trying to do is to use data clay into these systems, mapping the objects into the NVRAM. No? The challenges that we have is how we can reference these objects for different applications, or the same object can be used by different applications. Also, how we can use the NVRAM. No? It's still very new, so we don't know what to do if we should store everything in the NVRAMs, which initially doesn't seem to make sense. If not, how we decide which objects should be mapped into the NVRAM. or if we should only use NVRAS as a fast storage, no? It's another option. Another challenge in NVRAN or in general in persistent storage is a problem that doesn't exist when you use non-persistent storage, is garbage collection. So everything that is persistent data will remain. So is using space, okay? So what happens if objects should not be there at some moment, how we delete them, no? And we are working on the integration with a programming model in this case. Another project is HiES. This is an ERC, a young ERC project from David Carrera. It's trying to map efficiently different heterogeneous workloads on HPC systems by using learning algorithms. They perform a feedback loop trying to define the task placement, where to execute the different applications, also where to map the data, and using software-defined environments in order to provide a whole self-adaptive system to more efficient manage the data centers. So that's a very ambitious project and tackling different aspects. Another one that has already finished, but I think it's relevant still, is the Rethink Big. Rethink Big was a road mapping project. The duration was 2 years, and the result has been a roadmap of the big data related to industry. And in general, the answers that they wanted, the questions they wanted to answer is how the technology in hardware and networking can be exploited in big data analytics, and how we can improve the European competitiveness in the area of big data. So this roadmap now is trying to be promoted, of course, as part of still of the effort. No? For example, we will be presenting it in a Spanish conference in Barcelona, for example, next month. And we are collaborating with other projects, but I selected a few of them that I considered more important. And finally, a highlight of some projects of industry, although some collaborations were mentioned by the presentation before. One is, for example, the project Aloja. It's very well known in the community. Has been working on doing benchmarking of mapping MapReduce workloads in different different deployments. So, and this then is stored in a repository, so people can browse and see the different results. They have done up to more than 50,000 runs of the high bench. These are different benchmarks from the big data people, TPC, Edge, and some of the big bench, in more than 100 hardware configurations. Not all of them are cloud configurations, can be cluster configurations or different cloud providers or on-premise HPC systems. Has been a project in collaboration mainly with HPC and with Microsoft, but also other vendors have been involved. As part of the collaboration with IBM that was described before, now there is this collaboration on active storage, which involves also the development of a new implementation of the SMAFIN application, the genomics application I was mentioning before. The idea would be to adapt these ideas into the IBM Open Power, and especially using the biggest storage technology, no? Trying to get the best from this storage architecture. And the workloads, in this case, the idea is to be able to run very large simulations on the order of 1,000 genomes, which represents 300 gigabytes of compressed data, each of one. No? So each genome has this amount of data. And the output would be to identify different mutation patterns and their connection to the genetics of the people. Another project is with CaixaBank. This has been also shown in the press. The problem with this project is that I cannot disclose any information. Myself, I don't know much about it, but I know that which is about machine learning and about data analytics. So probably some of the results sometime will be outlined, disclosed, but right now I cannot say much. No? So a bit as a conclusion, we've seen a bit the different activities where you can do, even you're at an HPC center, that you can do big data. No? Still, we think that we have a lot of applications, which shows a lot of visibility to us, but still we think we can do more, no? That we need more lighthouse applications, because at the end, if you don't appear in the press because of this cancer research or of the climate, it's very difficult that they know you for your technologies. No? And also, we think that there should be more practices towards this possibility of interactivity, no? Visualization, steering of the applications, and on-demand processes. And also that we need more emphasis in order to do workflows that can be defined more on demand, no? More depending on the results of the analytics to decide to do more simulation, not just to plan. I want to do all this, explore all this design exploration, no? And maybe some of the points don't make sense, no? Maybe you can do better, more intelligent search of the design space, no? Also, we need more research in ourselves. No, the BSC is not an expert on analytics, and especially our director is very excited with the idea of doing research on the cognitive area. No, and part of this, hopefully, we will do it with IBM. And also, there has been a lot of cross-department activities, but it's something that still is very important, and we should do more. Okay, and this is all from my side. Thank you.